The ayes have it. The ayes have it. The next item on the order paper is a motion on the values and principles of the Good Friday Agreement. The Business Committee has agreed to allow up to 1 hour 30 minutes for this debate. The proposer of the motion will have 10 minutes to propose and 10 minutes to wind. One amendment has been selected and is published on the Marshall List. The proposer will have 10 minutes to propose the amendment and 5 minutes to wind. All other speakers will have 5 minutes. I will ask the clerk to read the motion.
But this Assembly calls on the British and Irish Governments to convene all party talks to identify how to affirm and promote the values and principles of the Good Friday Agreement, to address issues that have arisen in relation to strands 1, 2 and 3 of the Agreement, to comprehensively and conclusively address all matters that have led to political instability and have been an impediment to reconciliation, and to further agree how to best protect the interests of the people.
Thank you. I call Colin McGrath to move the motion. Glaim or Colin McGrath and Rúna Bogu.
Thank you very much, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker. I rise this evening to propose the motion about the principles of the Good Friday Agreement. The people of Ireland North and South overwhelmingly endorsed the Good Friday Agreement in 1998 after the talks, which were the culmination of the peace process, which brought ceasefires to our communities, saw violence removed from our streets and brought hope to the people of the North. In that moment of hope, people were led to believe that we would deliver a future that was free from the shackles of the past. And, Madam Deputy Speaker, we must acknowledge and we must never lose sight of where we are now and just how far we have come. But the process is always fraught with dangers and indeed worries. Only just last night we had one of our police officers shot whilst carrying out his work to try and deliver a safe and welcoming community in North Belfast. We had last night people that believed that it was acceptable for them to head out of their homes, to pick up weapons and to seek out a young police officer and target him with death. Nothing could be further away from the principles of the Good Friday Agreement, and I offer him my best wishes for his recovery. What happened last night was a failure of some to live up to the core of the Good Friday Agreement and to ensure respect, parity of esteem and indeed equality. However, I note that where we are in society now, Madam Speaker, isn't the place where we could be. We have consistently asked for a political process, not a security process, a political solution, not a paramilitary one. And if you were to ask us, would we have the Good Friday Agreement again, then our reply would be yes, yes and yes. For sure we would do it again. It has been and remains a sound roadmap to the society that we want and to the type of community that wider society needs. It's an agreement that addresses the people of the North. That's strand one. It addresses the relationship between the people of the North and the rest of Ireland. That was strand two. And it addresses the relationship between the people of Ireland and Britain. That was strand three. These three strands were underpinned by the basic principles that must always extend in any civil society: respect, parity of esteem and equality, to name but three. These strands and principles should have been the standards of the past. They should be the principles of the present. And for us, they are still part of the vision for the future. The SDLP has warned that real damage has been done to the concept and practice of the Good Friday Agreement, particularly in the last 10 years. We warned that the spirit and substance of the agreement was being degraded. We said that the DUP were attempting to reconfigure the agreement in the image of the old world that they knew and loved. We were public in saying that Sinn Féin were agreeing to government on DUP terms. I mean, where did all the new roads go? And where do they not go? And where is the Equality Bill? Where is the Irish Language Bill? A dedicated anti-poverty strategy? Is that in the programme for government applauded by the DUP and Sinn Féin only 8 weeks ago? The DUP, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker, have tried hard to diminish the value, contribution and substance of the Good Friday Agreement, and Sinn Féin have been weak and powerless to prevent them. Where is the equality? Maybe that's a different slant on the Trojan horses that we hear about. The SDLP spoke straight with the people of Northern Ireland. We said that the fresh start was not what it claimed to be. Others were not straight, and the fresh start has proven to be a false start. We were straight with the people of Northern Ireland. We told them that we would not go into government on DUP terms. Others did, with no firm commitments on equality, language, North-South, equal marriage, and nothing on addressing the deep concerns that the public about the public finances and how they are managed. We were straight when others weren't. And in the last weeks of last year, the DUP and Sinn Féin said that they were working hard for people, with articles in the Belfast Telegraph and briefings about how great things were. Now we know the truth. We were straight with the people of Northern Ireland when others weren't. And the question, of course, now is, how does Northern Ireland keep going in the direction of, do we go in the direction of failure, or do we affirm the Good Friday Agreement, its values and its ambition? One of the core principles of the Good Friday Agreement, by its very nature, is that it accommodates different ambitions, different identities, and gathers us all around the right set of values. In essence, it's about the radical middle, because that middle is needed for all of the Good Friday Agreement and its institutions to work to its maximum. For its ambitions to be realised, it needs people and parties who are fully committed to the values and the outworkings. 10 years of DUP rule with Sinn Féin consent has failed us, and it will continue to fail us. We have a different ambition. We call on people to get back to the heart and the soul of the Good Friday Agreement. We call on government to affirm the heart, soul and practices of the agreement. We call for all party talks that embed, not erode, the value of the Good Friday Agreement, and grow, not sideline, any of strand 1, strand 2 or strand 3, none of the requirements that deal with all the unresolved issues and help us to address the horror that is coming down the line with Brexit. Now, this is no easy task, but then the SDLP has never gone down the easy road. We faced down state violence and paramilitary terror. We argued for a political accommodation, for policing reform, and for a government that knew much of its business was about jobs, about houses and about health.
I appreciate the member giving way. The member makes reference to the new start on policing. He also made reference to equality. The member agree that it's hardly a fair or basic, decent situation to have where people were discriminated actively against on the basis of their religion when applying for a job?
I think that many things had to happen as a result of the Good Friday Agreement that addressed tens, if not hundreds, of years of imbalance, and some things had to be swallowed in order to give us a fair and equal society. But we now say to the two governments that they must show their good authority and have all party talks across the full range of current requirements. Sinn Féin have, in a panic, rushed us to the ballot box. Even their core constituency could no longer accept government on DUP terms, including the RHI on DUP terms. In order to catch up, Sinn Féin have panicked and gone for an election. But let's be careful, because that could be an election that could end up giving London more power here to do their worst. A London government that is going to be all at once hard unionist, hard Brexit and hard Tory. We cannot allow London, we cannot allow Sinn Féin or the DUP to do any more damage to the democratic will of the people of Ireland and to her agreement. Thank you.
Stephen Agnew on Lasso Abogo. I call Stephen Agnew to move the amendment.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. The Green Party believes that the traditional parties have wasted the opportunities of the Good Friday Agreement. This was the people's agreement. And I say that with a degree of kind of personal passion, because I turned 18 the year of the referendum. I wouldn't have said I was political at the time. I was passionate about many things, but not those reflected in Northern Ireland politics. Nor did I come from a political family. But for the first time, we were discussing politics at home and round the table. And we had a real debate in the House, and without giving away the confidentiality of my family, not everyone in the House voted for it. And it was a divided House in that regard. But it was genuine engagement, and it really did feel like we had a say, and we had a stake in the future of Northern Ireland. But then when the traditional parties got power, they guarded it jealously. It stopped being the people's agreement and became about politicians in Stormont and about what they wanted and about how they wished to interpret the Good Friday Agreement. Now we're having proposals to cede power either back to Westminster from some parties or even joint power with the Irish government. And the Green Party would reject that. We believe that's the absolutely wrong direction of travel. That takes the people's agreement further away from them. What the Green Party proposes to do instead is to have a constitutional convention, devolve power back to the people and give citizens a real stake on what happens here. If we go back to 2007, the St Andrews Agreement, one of two things happened. Either, as the DUP claimed, the agreement was fundamentally changed, and they had opposed the agreement, but this was something that they supported. In which case, I would say to them, 72% of people voted for that agreement. What gave you the right to change it? You did it after an election, not before. Where was your mandate to do that? Alternatively, it was tinkered with, as some suggested, and ultimately the institutions remained largely unchanged. But either way, I've always argued there's been a democratic deficit since then. Since St Andrews, we've had the Hillsborough Agreement, we've had the Haas talks, we've had the Fresh Start Agreement, or False Dawn, as some refer to it now. I'll give way. Oh, sorry, it was David Ford. Okay. Credit to Mr. Ford for the term, False Dawn. And each of these agreements that have happened, negotiations happening in secret behind closed doors without the light of public scrutiny, have chiselled away at the Good Friday Agreement, at the People's Agreement, which is why I support the intention of the motion coming forward from the SDLP. But equally, I recognise this is 20 years on. And whilst I, as an 18-year-old, did get to vote in the referendum for the Good Friday Agreement, there are those who will be voting in March who can't remember 1998, never mind have had the opportunity to vote. So I don't think it's just about going back to the values and principles. I think we go back to the agreement, we review it, we reform it, and revitalise it. And we go forward with a new agreement, a new deal that is suitable for today and indeed for the future. Because you can't keep having crises. We can't keep having year after year. At one point it seemed to be the annual Christmas tradition. We have to have crisis talks. And institutions and agreement that are continually in crisis do need to be looked at again with today's context in mind. So yes, I think we should go back to those principles and values, but we must go forward with a new agreement endorsed by today's generation. Because we sometimes use the term ugly scaffolding, and again, I'm sure somebody will enlighten me who came up with that. I think it might have been Mark Durkin. There you go. I was going to say Seamus Mallon, so glad I didn't. We talk about the ugly scaffolding in the Good Friday Agreement, and there's no doubt it was of its time and it was of its context. It was about getting peace on the road, but I hope we're somewhat down that road now, and I do think that it is time to look again at the ugly scaffolding and to see if we can make it that bit more beautiful. The Green Party proposes a constitutional convention, and the idea is to bring citizens together with politicians to allow them to become part of the decision-making process. It would be a time-bound process, so it doesn't have to be lengthy. We can put a timeline on it, a deadline on it, and come to conclusions on issues that these institutions have found intractable, but I believe, with the right structures in place, could be resolved. Because when we bring the public in, we stop having the fears that all parties have about watching their vote, watching their back, what will their rival parties do. Ultimately, the end of any process should be to referendum. So you let the people decide. And in that, cynically or otherwise, you have political cover. What issues could we address? I think for me, where my party would like to start is the community designation that enshrines sectarian division in our institutions, and tied to that, the petition of concern that has led us to the point of some of the crises and continues to frustrate progress in this Assembly. I also believe, as part of a new constitution for Northern Ireland, or at least an updated constitution, that we need to enshrine transparency of political donations. If 1998 started the normalisation of politics in Northern Ireland, this is an essential part of continuing that normalisation. And the issue of voluntary coalition, which there seems to be an increasing degree of support for. These are the types of things that we can put and engage with the electorate on and seek their views and include them in the process. There are other issues that many have highlighted that remain unresolved from the Good Friday Agreement. Irish language legislation is an obvious one. A Bill of Rights, and never more important that we discuss that issue in light of a possible exit from Europe. And as well as that, the civic forum. Again, it doesn't have to be about bringing something back, but looking forward to how do we engage citizens on a continual basis? How do we make sure the people's agreement is exactly that? It's an agreement for the people, and that they do have a continued stake in decision making. And the model works. We have a template in the Irish Convention on the Constitution. Unlike Northern Ireland, the Irish Constitution cannot be changed without citizens' consent. That's what I would like to see here going forward. But I can honestly say the Irish Convention, the Constitution, which I was very privileged to be part of, was one of the best pieces of deliberative democracy I've ever seen. It was genuinely something to see a true engagement between politicians and or other citizens, and see people have a say that made a difference. And ultimately, the Republic of Ireland were able to tackle, for example, the sometimes seen as politically divisive issue of equal marriage, and were able to resolve that in a dignified way and put it to a public vote with the result, unsurprising to me, but perhaps was maybe more surprising to those looking from the outside, that so-called Catholic Ireland does support equality for the LGBT community. And I believe that Northern Ireland, the people of Northern Ireland, do also. It is my view that we can bring forward proposals through engagement with the public to really bring these institutions up to what we expect in the current context. The process, as it was in the Republic, should be open and transparent, and this contrasts to the dodgy deals such as Fresh Start. The current constitutional crisis presents us with an opportunity for change, and we should not waste it.
I call Christopher Stalford.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. Listening to the last speaker, I was delighted to hear a strong and robust defence of referenda and the integrity of their outcomes and how they should be protected. I hope that he abides by that principle going forward. Listening to the person that brought the motion, I noted the words "the old world that they love" were used in reference to myself as a member of the Democratic Unionist Party. I can only talk, I suppose, about my family experience and my family background when he talks about the old world that they love. I'm quite proud of the fact that on my mother's side, no one has voted for the Ulster Unionist Party since the foundation of the state. They were Northern Ireland Labour Party people. They were Northern Ireland Labour Party people because they saw the Ulster Unionist Party as the Tory party. They were trade union people, working class people who worked in the shipyard, came from the bottom of Newton Arch Road. And they were very supportive of the Northern Ireland Labour Party. And they would never have voted for what they saw as the Tories. And I remember asking, just one second, I will. Yes, I will to the modern day Tory. Yes, I will. happy to give way in a second. And I remember asking, it was actually my granny, why did you always vote Labour? She said, because they gave us the NHS. And so when you talk about the old world, you might well be talking about aristocracy and unionist gentry, but let me assure you, that's not my people and that's not who I come from. So that is not an old world that I look back on or want. I want us to use devolution in order to improve the lives of the people that we are sent here to represent. Devolution is a valuable tool for us to improve the lives of the people that we are sent here to represent. I'll give way to Mr. Nesbitt.
I thank Mr. Selford. I didn't pick up whether your parents are still around, still alive. If they are, could you tell them what they've said, and if not, what do you think they would say about the Conservative Party conference, where your party hosted a champagne reception?
And the member has an extra minute.
I think in truthfulness, what they would say, and my father's no longer with us, but what my mother would say would be that it's in the interest of unionism to make friends in all the political parties, not hitch ourselves to one, as you did in UConf, which prompted your political career. Well, only insofar as not while Corbyn's the leader, but afterwards, hopefully. When people talk about 10 years of failure, I've made this point previously. I must remind you that for 9.5 of those years, you were part of that government as well. And I think your party and the Ulster Unionists and the Alliance, Sinn Féin and ourselves, over the course of that 10 years, have achievements that we can point to that materially improved the lives of our constituents, that made things better for the people that we are sent here to represent. And if devolution isn't about making the lives of our constituents better, well then of course people are going to question the value of it or why we should have it. When you talk about the values of the Belfast Agreement, one of the issues that I've already put to you relates to the destruction of the RUC, and as a consequence of that, Protestants from Northern Ireland were the only people it was legal to discriminate against in the entirety of the European Union on the basis of their religion. And whether or not you make an argument that that is about addressing culture or historical imbalances, that was the reality. So I'm very glad you mentioned St Andrews. I'm very glad that at St Andrews that was negotiated away, and once the percentage reached 30% of people in the PSNI, the discriminatory rule in terms of 50-50 recruitment was done away with. So I don't think those are the sorts of values that we as a society should embrace or celebrate or support. Mention was made about moving to talks and to the ugly scaffolding. I'm absolutely up for that. I absolutely am, and I would welcome that, because I think there are things about the way in which this system works. Some of them are hangovers from 1998. Some of them come from 2007 onwards. I'm absolutely up for fundamental reform of the way in which government operates here. I think that that is in keeping with the mood of where our people are at. And despite where we're heading, I actually believe Northern Ireland is at a point, and our people are at a point, where we no longer need enforced mandatory coalition. We are mature enough as a society. There will be no going back, no matter what happens as a consequence of where we're at presently. No one seriously thinks that Northern Ireland society will slip back to where it was when I was born in 1983. No one thinks we're going back there.
Can the member bring his remarks to a close?
I will. I think we're in a better place, and I think our people are up for fundamental root and branch reform, and I would welcome the opportunity to participate in it. And in my last 4 seconds, if you give me just one second, I was about to wish you all the best. Retirement, but fair enough.
I'd like to call Gerry Kelly.
Good morning, and I wish you all the best as well. I'm going to begin by repeating something Martin McGuinness said actually just a few days ago, that all of us in political life have a duty and a responsibility to stand up for all sections of society. And for me, that's what the Good Friday Agreement is all about. Mutual respect, equality and parity esteem are the core principles of the Good Friday Agreement. They're fundamental principles that should not only inform our day-to-day interactions and decision-making, but if embraced with confidence and commitment, can also lead us all out of the mire of the past antagonisms and perhaps into a better shared future. It is worth remembering, however, certainly in way at least of context, that for almost 80 years, despite what Christopher Stalford says, nationalists living in the North had to endure unionist and British political domination and endemic discrimination in a deeply unequal society. So mutual respect, equality and party of esteem, those handful of words just mean such an awful lot. They also, I suppose, ask a lot of us. They ask us to reach out to our fellow citizens in a spirit of tolerance, yes, but also with a measure of acceptance. Acceptance of cultural, political and religious differences that exist between us. Acceptance of different sexual orientation and gender identification. Different family formations and life choices. Acceptance of racial and ethnic differences and so much more. But what none of us should ever accept is the idea that those differences can never justify inequality and disrespect. We collectively need to give full effect to the Good Friday Agreement provisions that include the establishment of a single Equality Act and a Bill of Rights for the North of Ireland and the creation of an All-Ireland Charter of Rights. In 1998, as previous members have said, through a process of dual referenda, the Good Friday Agreement was democratically endorsed by an overwhelming majority of voters. So when the Green Party talks about a new agreement, the people and about the people speaking, the people have already spoken in terms of this, North and South. And that was a hugely important moment in our shared history. The agreement envisaged a Bill of Rights, particular to the circumstances of the North. The clear import of this was that to have a maximum approach to rights protection.
And he says the people have spoken, but I would point out that it's almost 20 years ago. So, for example, on the issue of a border poll, would he be content that it be changed to every 20 years? I suspect he wouldn't see that as frequently enough.
I suppose if the people have spoken, they said every 7 years. But that aside, the core problem we face now is not in the agreement, and I think this is the core issue, reached through negotiations. The problem is that there have been obstacles continually put in place and the implementation of important aspects of the agreements, not only the Good Friday Agreement, by the way, by Unionists and the British Government. And those issues include the Irish Language Act, Act McGallaghan, an All-Ireland Charter of Rights, the Single Equality Act, the Mayor's Long Cash Peace Centre, and the legacy of the power structures more recently. Now, this is still a society of many inequalities and great divisions. As many as 1 in 5 people have a disability, and people with a disability are twice as likely to be unemployed. 1 in 3 children here live in poverty. 1/3 of those who are economically inactive have no qualifications. Sectarian and racist attacks still happen all too frequently, and homophobic attitudes and hate crime remains part of our experience, and of course the gender pay gap continues. Yet despite these difficulties, the will to change is already out there, and it's in our communities. That, unfortunately, is not reflected within political unionism. A survey carried out by the Equality Commission found that 91% of people in the North supported equality laws. So, my view, it's time for a step change, and the Good Friday Agreement is fundamental to that. To have a properly functioning, power-sharing executive and assembly, there needs to be a belief, as well as a commitment, to mutual respect, equality and parity of esteem. And let me say this again. See, whether you're talking about legislation or you're talking about agreements, you can get the best agreements in the world, you can get the best equality legislation, you get the best type of legislation in the world. It's not enough. It gives you the structure upon which to build. But if you do not have the political will, then all of those will fall. So you can put it to the people and you can have another agreement, but if there is not the political will, then it will fall. And I suppose, let me finish with this, with political unionists, the question is, will they eventually step up to the plate? Grimoga.
I call Mike Nesbitt.
Principal Deputy Speaker, I'm glad you're still here, but good luck thereafter. I rise to support the motion, not the amendment, because I believe that after the 2nd of March, whoever the 90 who are who come back here, in very well-paid jobs, their responsibility is to get on with it and to start governing and to start offering an effective opposition. And I fear to simply say our first act would be to throw it back to the people sends out the wrong signal. But yes, talks now seem pretty much inevitable and perhaps worth it if short-term uncertainty brings us longer-term stability. But I put in this, I think, very important proviso. When we come back after the 2nd of March, we'll be very close to the Prime Minister triggering Article 50 and the two-year negotiation on the exit from the European Union. And it is critical that we start making our voice heard. And this executive is folding without having published a single A4 sheet of paper about the vision for Northern Ireland beyond the European Union, about the plan for how we maximise the advantages to us, or any asks. Nothing. Not even the priorities and whether we think they clash or complement Mrs May's priorities. And we're in no doubt, I am sure we're in no doubt, some of our priorities will clash with hers. And what are we going to do about it? How are we making the case? And what are the communication channels? But yes, negotiations and a return to the values and the principles. And sometimes, Principal Deputy Speaker, I think some of our members confuse values and principles with actions. And there were actions associated with the 98 agreement, which were transitional arrangements, which were painful, particularly for unionists. Mr Stalford basically tried to imply that the agreement wrote in the destruction of the RUC. Not quite right. It wrote in a review which led to Patton, which led to the recommendation that we reform. But if you really support the police, would you not be listening to somebody like the Chief Constable, who was a proud member of the Royal Ulster Constabulary, saying he's now proud to lead the PSNI and very grateful of the fact it commands more support than the RUC ever could have, for whatever reason. And the painful early release of prisoners, which Mr Stalford referred to last week. But no prisoner would still be in prison. And unless I'm very much mistaken, one of the prisoners who availed of early release was Diestedt, you know, that darling of the DUP. So let's get away from the transitional arrangements and start focusing in on the values and the principles. Paragraph 2. We must never forget those who've died or been injured and their families, but we can best honour them through a fresh start. Ah, the words of the agreement, a fresh start, in which we dedicate ourselves to the achievement of reconciliation, tolerance and mutual trust. And I'm afraid in my assessment of the last 10 years, where the DUP and Sinn Féin have shared the space of the Stormont Castle, there has not been enough effort to achieve those values and those principles. Paragraph 2 said, the tragedy of the past has left deep and profoundly regrettable legacies of suffering. And indeed, at the beginning of those 10 years, I and three others were called to the castle by the then First Minister Ian Paisley and Deputy First Minister Martin McGuinness and asked to set up a commission for victims and survivors. Incredibly challenging to ask four people co-equally to take that forward. And of course, as it turned out, one was a member of the SDLP, one had an association of some depth, undefined, with the DUP. One had lost a brother who had been an IRA man, shot dead by the army, and then the fourth, who had no political affiliation at the time, is now leading the Ulster Unionist Party. Certainly no public declaration of support. Very, very challenging thing to be asked to do, and yet we got on with it. And I tell you what's different between what we did and what happens in here. We argued, but you never heard us argue. We argued behind closed doors, and we found a position that we could take out positively and united to the public. And we do just the opposite. And I remember being in UTV and the arguments on live television, and then taking the politicians upstairs to the green room, and they'd crack a Budweiser and they'd say, "How's your big son getting on at uni?" We do it the wrong way round. So yeah, let's get back. Let's get back to the values and the principles of the agreement. Principal Deputy Speaker, I wish you well as you open the next chapter in your life.
I call Stephen Farry.
Madam Principal Deputy Speaker, it is clear that we are going to have a talks process after the election. That does need to be both an intensive process but also a very focused process, where we do need to address a range of very difficult and challenging issues, and indeed to look to some of the structures that have been holding us back over the past number of years. I am glad that the motion refers to the values and principles of the Good Friday Agreement, because I think it is important that we do recognise that those are very durable, and they are something we should constantly remind ourselves of and return to on a regular basis, particularly whenever we are at times of political difficulty. But it is important that we do make that distinction between the values and principles and the Pacific structures. While my party was supportive of the Good Friday Agreement back in 1998, at that time we expressed some reservations around some of the very detailed nature of the proposals and how they, in due course, could potentially destabilise Northern Ireland and also prevent us from realising our full potential. I think we have been vindicated in that analysis very much. But even if you dispute that particular point, looking back almost 20 years to Good Friday, it is clear that our structures have been holding us back in more recent times, and there is a need for some degree of change. I concur with remarks that have been made, both by Mike Nisbet and Gerry Kelly, that ultimately power sharing can only work if there is trust, mutual respect and partnership between those who are attempting to share power. And in practice, what we've had in many of our attempts at power sharing is more of a power carve-up, where we almost have a transactional approach towards the executive rather than a situation of genuine partnership, where we're looking to a common vision of Northern Ireland and moving ahead in a coherent manner. But structures do matter, and if designed correctly, they can further incentivise cooperation. But whenever they are drawn incorrectly, they can disincentivise cooperation or indeed provide blockages. And it is worth referencing perhaps three particular aspects in this regard. The fact that we have the mutual vetoes within the executive, the fact that we have the petition of concern, and the fact that we have institutionalised sectarianism most clearly demonstrated through the use of designations in the Assembly, but also permeating through some wider aspects of our public policy and the inability to address those. And I have to say in particular to Sinn Féin, who are making great play at the moment about their demand for equality now, that they are stressing the term now, because they have been passing up opportunities in the past to address equality issues. We have made much of the fact that whenever we were offered the opportunity to take on the justice portfolio back in May of last year, that we had five what we viewed as reasonable demands at that stage. The first one was a reform of the petition of concern to take it back to the original intent when it was designed in 1998. It is clear at that stage Darling Foster banged the table and said, "No, never, we're not doing that. That's a way where we're going to have to fold on equal marriage, not happening." But at the same time, Sinn Féin were also very clear that they weren't for budging on the issue of the petition of concern. There is this notion that Sinn Féin are seeking to force through equality issues through talks process after talks process. But the far better way is to ensure that we are able to address equality issues, human rights issues, on an ongoing basis through the provision of a natural process of deliberation and building sufficient consensus, and one where there's not the risk of a veto being inappropriately used. What I would say is that if they are serious about addressing equality issues, albeit belatedly, and I would draw to their attention there has been virtually no progress on equality issues under devolution over the past 10 years, then they have to be serious about reform of structures and not just making demands as to what they seek to do in that particular regard. In closing, I just also want to make a point in relation to Brexit, and we have a comment from that the Brexit in itself doesn't challenge the formal structures of the Good Friday Agreement. In a way, that is correct if you take it to an extreme literal sense. But what it does challenge is the underlying assumptions that empower the Good Friday Agreement, where people can actually move on a north-south, east-west basis freely. What Brexit does is correct barriers. It also interferes with people's scope to have open, mixed and multiple identities, and puts people back in their single identities, which goes against the whole spirit of what we're trying to achieve under the Good Friday Agreement. Thank you.
Thank you. I call Pam Cameron.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. And obviously my party was not a signatory to the Good Friday Agreement, because at that time we were not fully persuaded that all the conditions which we believed necessary to satisfy our own concerns were not in place at that time. And it turns out that we were in fact right about that.
Right.
And whilst many individuals went forward in good faith and indeed paid a heavy political price, others who were signed up to the agreement continued to live double lives. They were peacemakers in public but remained wedded to paramilitarism in private. And all of the things that we were led to believe were left behind were in fact still in place. Paramilitary command structures were still in place and possibly remain in place this very day. Acts of terror and violence against communities or former comrades were carried out when deemed appropriate. And this was not just an inability of an organisation to rein a few loose cannons. This was an organisation whose most senior leader continued to shield paedophiles and oversee the clean-up operations of continued paramilitary murders, and I refer to the cases of Paul Quinn and Robert McCartney, to name but a few. That may be uncomfortable listening for some, however, they are the facts, and those facts are partly the cause of reluctance from within unionism to fully function within a partnership government. That's not to say that we do not wish to be partners in government, it is only an illustration of why there remains a difficulty over issues of trust. I do, however, accept that trust does indeed go both ways. As far as I'm concerned personally, I don't think I've ever caused any personal offence to any other individual member or any party in this chamber. It's not how I want to do business. I am very happy to sit down with members of any party on any issue that moves a society forward. I accept that some positions my party takes on certain issues are unpopular in some quarters and may be seen as disrespectful or intolerant, but I will never be found wanting when it comes to listening to the concerns and views of others. In concluding my remarks, I would say that it is deeply regrettable that the institutions have collapsed and we are heading to an election. I would have preferred that all the facts around all of the issues would have been fully investigated and any appropriate blame had been apportioned before deciding to collapse the very institutions who are capable of ensuring that the investigation takes place. The President of Sinn Féin may believe that equality is merely a Trojan horse, but that is not my view, never will be my view, and if I am fortunate enough to find myself back in this chamber at some point in the future, I will only be too happy to be reminded of that pledge. I hope that others can make that same commitment. Finally, Principal Deputy Speaker, is it not possible to recognise that the Good Friday Agreement was almost 20 years ago? We have had subsequent agreements and indeed elections, and things have moved on. This is a time when we should be focusing on the future. Let's look at solutions for 2017 as opposed to rehashing over and over again 1998. Thank you.
Éirim Saoire, Alex Maskey. I call Alex Maskey.
Margaret, Principal Deputy Speaker, and pre-Blaskan Cúrlan, I also wish you well in the time ahead as a Republican activist. I think it's probably fairly maybe ironic in its own way that in the last sort of hours of this particular assembly that we're debating the principles of the and the values of the Good Friday Agreement. And actually, on behalf of our party, I would hope that when we come back off the elections, that people do apply all of ourselves to the full implementation of the Good Friday Agreement, because quite clearly part of the problem and part of the reason why we are where we are today is, of course, the very recent financial scandal around the RHI, which is on the end of a long list of other financial scandals, which has really brought public confidence in the institution to an all-time low. But also alongside of that, and maybe at times more important than that, that the power sharing and the concept and the principles and the values of the Good Friday Agreement have not been adhered to by parties in here. And I'm speaking in particular, for example, with regard to the DUP. And it's interesting to listen to our colleague, Palm Cameron, who did acknowledge in fairness that the DUP, for whatever reasons, while we agree with them or not, but have difficulties with power sharing. And we would agree that they have difficulties with sharing power. To the DUP credit, they actually opposed the Good Friday Agreement. They never supported it. They did everything they could to thwart that. And that was their position, which they were entitled to have. But fortunately, all of the other parties involved in the all-party talks, both of the governments, and more importantly, the people in referendum across this island voted overwhelmingly to endorse the Good Friday Agreement. All parties and all participants and all communities, I would argue, and Sinn Féin would argue, made major compromises in order to agree to the Good Friday Agreement and subsequent agreements in the ensuing number of years. So we would argue very clearly that we are working under the auspices of the Good Friday Agreement. We are very disappointed that many key elements of it, and my colleague Gerry Kelly has already referred to a number of them, have not been adhered to over the last number of years. And I think it has been made very clear again also that you can legislate and you can make laws and you can set up institutions and all the rest of that within a particular framework. But if people choose not to embrace the principles and the concepts, then it's not going to work. And that is why coming from a divided society, a society in conflict for generations, that you cannot expect the garden to be rosy all the time. That's why there needs to be safeguards and checks and balances built in. That's why we have mechanisms like the petition of concern and the mutual vetoes, which is really, on a positive basis, it's about requiring cross-community support on certain key issues of governance. The fact that some people will abuse the POC doesn't mean to say that the mechanism isn't still necessary for a whole range of issues. And I think we've all been challenged over the last number of years about things that we've had to do, agreements that we've had to reach, agreements that we've had to be challenged to adhere to, and so on. But nevertheless, when people have worked in the spirit of partnership and in the spirit of sharing power, this place and this executive and previous executives have produced much better work. When people work together, when they have embraced the concept of sharing the power rather than trying to simply divide it out, then obviously this place has produced much better results for the wider public and I think for society as a whole. It's when people reside from the concept of sharing power and treating people mutually with respect and affording equality to other citizens, that's when we become not fit for purpose and not fit to be in position. And I would argue that in recent times, again, there has been an increasing abuse of the likes of the POC. The POC, as I've said, was built in there as a safeguard in order to make sure that there was sufficient concern that mustered the marshalling of 30 signatures. Then obviously that denoted that there was a serious problem, which then needed to have the particular matter under discussion, requiring cross-community support. No, thank you. I don't have that much time, Chris, sorry about that. But the fact of the matter is that, so that was a safeguard, but people are now using the POC as a veto, in other words, as a block to other people's rights. And once you start using the POC to block other people's rights, then that is a completely and utterly a flagrant abuse of the use of the POC. So we would argue that people do need to return to what the POC was about. It was the protection and one of the mechanisms to make sure that one community or one set of parties don't abuse or discriminate against another. So they are positive mechanisms, and we would appeal to all parties coming back after the elections to embrace the spirit of partnership, because if we sit down not having a whole new negotiation, but simply working to implement the agreements, then we'll all serve the people far better.
I call Philip Logan.
Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker. I was 9 years of age when the Good Friday Agreement was signed, so for me that feels like a long time ago. But people of my generation, and I remember at school in Collybackie High School, reading the Good Friday Agreement, reading the outworkings of that, and Googling a lot of the attributes of it. And some of it was quite amazing. And I can understand why people would struggle to understand a lot of it in relation to when you Google names that were let out of prison and you read about their history. It is very difficult. It is very difficult to understand and take that in, even as someone who wasn't really around in those times or certainly wasn't able to understand those things at that time. I think, to be fair, in this room, in this chamber, as we've discussed this, there is a consensus that we all want the best for Northern Ireland, and we make that claim. And as an optimist, I would assume that the most of us in this chamber mean that in making that claim. The problem is, and the problem starts, has been said, that we all differ on what we think, and by extension what our electorate thinks, the best thing for Northern Ireland is. The Good Friday Agreement, understandably, was an attempt to try and move Northern Ireland forward, regardless of those political differences. This party, over the last 10 years, has been trying and have made a huge effort in trying to move Northern Ireland forward and move Northern Ireland in the right direction, even though that is very difficult when we are and when it's necessary for us to do business with a party that we don't really want to, and as I think one of our party members said quite rightly in the past, that sometimes we have to hold our nose to do that business. So I'm sure people can understand our difficulty, and Mr. Maskey is right to say he understands how difficult that is, and I appreciate that. But we've always taken steps to try and move Northern Ireland forward. I think we were making... Way. Yes, happy to give way.
I appreciate the member giving way. The member says what he said. Would he agree with me that when people talk about making sacrifices or making compromises, it's not much of a sacrifice, it's not much of a compromise to stop killing people, to stop bombing the place,
that's right,
and to come up to the same basic democratic standards that everyone else has to abide by who participates in politics? That's not a compromise. That's meeting the basic minimum requirements.
And the member has an extra minute.
Thank you, and thanks to the member for that contribution. And he's absolutely right. It really shouldn't be an expectation to ask for those things. It should just be part and parcel of life and human decency. I think we were making progress. It was slow, it was laboured, but nonetheless, I think we're making progress. I had hoped, when I entered politics and for the last number of years, I had hoped that we were able to discuss policies, discuss positive policies rather than political point scoring. But our counterpart in government have decided that they weren't just getting enough out of the deal. They started to get selfish and lost sight of the greater good, something the former Deputy First Minister, Mr. McGuinness, had formally embraced. He worked with Ian Paisley, he worked with Peter Robinson, and more recently Arlene Foster for a short time. We were making real progress, but no more. To be honest, I have no idea what lies ahead of an election. But I have no doubt that there will be talks, as this motion indicates, whether that's about building on what we have already attempted to achieve or maybe a new way forward. There will need to be genuine effort made on all sides. One side cannot throw in the towel if they decide that they're just not getting quite enough. It has to be talks, it has to be negotiation, and it has to be fair. We need to work away. We need to work on finding a way on things that we don't agree with, things that are not mutually exclusive or contentious. We have already begun to comprehensively and conclusively address the RHI issue. However, and as I said last week in this House, RHI isn't the real reason that Sinn Féin have pulled the institutions down. We've heard from Mr. Kelly's contribution, Irish language, a united Ireland, and equality. Yes, happy to give way.
On the renewable heat incentive, if I heard you right, you said you are now addressing comprehensively and conclusively the renewable heat incentive debacle. Did you not listen to your minister? This is a 12-month stopgap.
Was the member in earlier on when Simon Hamilton outlined the plan? You know, I see this as a way forward. I think this is positive. You know, there was an issue, there was a problem. There was a problem, and we've addressed that. That's what the people of Northern Ireland want. And as a result of elections will not fix this. Elections will not make it right. But certainly we've put in place steps to try and do that. But they've used Irish language, united Ireland, and equality. Those are some of the things cited as factors in this election. There is no secret that we will not give an inch on some of the issues that they would like us to. I believe in equality, and let me make that clear. I believe in equality, but I don't believe in Sinn Féin's definition of equality, as again I said last week, in the form of a Trojan horse. A united Ireland is decided by the people. Everyone, including Sinn Féin, knows well. that there's absolutely no appetite for a united Ireland. Some of these issues that are cited as equality are being used as pawns. But let's talk about them. Let's not polarise people with different opinions. I want us to focus on all the people of Northern Ireland. I may sound frustrated here, and I have said it before, but let me repeat it. I am frustrated because I want to protect the interests of the people of Northern Ireland, those who have elected me, those who are in need of help. We need to go out after this, we need to come in after this election and move forward and not go back to the past, and we will certainly have no attempts to rewrite the past. Thank you, Madam Principal Deputy Speaker.
I call Doug Beattie.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. Madam Speaker, I was overseas when the Belfast Agreement referendum took place. My father held my proxy vote, and I remember speaking to him about the referendum. And now, my dad spent 22 years in the Royal Ulster Rifles and then another 8 years in the Ulster Defence Regiment. He never talked politics. He would never talk religion. He would never proportion blame. He understood that in any conflict, there will always be competing narratives. But he said to me, Douglas, he always called me Douglas. He said to me, Douglas, there are many aspects of this agreement I don't like. In particular, I don't like releasing terrorists from prison until they've completed their sentences. And I don't like it that we're not decommissioning first. They've been responsible for the murder of our family, our friends, our colleagues, and our neighbours. But for Northern Ireland, for our children, for your children, for the ability for you to come back to Northern Ireland and live again, we have to take a chance. This is a once-in-a-generation time to have peace in Northern Ireland. He voted in favour of the Belfast Agreement. But I wonder what he would say today. Would he have voted for the Belfast Agreement had he known about the on-the-run schemes and the comfort letters? What about the unbalanced justice systems that we're seeing now, where the Director of Public Prosecutions can direct the PSNI to investigate state forces but ignores the terrorists? Would he have voted for the Belfast Agreement if he knew that after releasing the terrorists from prison and dismantling the maze and dismantling the special treatment, that all we would do is reset it up all over again? One party openly giving support for dissident special treatment, while another party in the executive not having the courage to end it. What would he have said if he had heard a unionist politician thanking a former terrorist for not killing us anymore? As honest and open as I was, I would have stopped short of thanking him, especially when former soldiers are in the dock and we have dissidents who are having their bail terms changed and we have a 75-year-old veteran who's being classed as a flight risk. It's unbalanced. It's unfair. I'll give way.
Forgive me, and I really didn't want to interrupt because I know he's passionate about the points that he's making, but I had meant to ask your party leader a while ago, because the party leader, also the Unionist party leader, just a number of months ago, if I remember correctly, said that if the Good Friday Agreement was up for debate now, that the party would not support that. Now, I'm hoping that all the parties would come back here, as I've said previously, with the commitment to deliver on the Good Friday Agreement, because I believe our problems are not because we had the Good Friday Agreement, but in fact that we haven't fully implemented the agreement. So could I ask, is your party still committed to the Good Friday Agreement? Because I think if we get that consensus in the chamber tonight, it'll be a good start.
And the member has an extra minute.
Thank you, Alex. Absolutely, to answer your question, and hopefully you will understand that my blood and thunder might diminish slightly in a moment or two. Mr. Speaker, it's clear to me that the political parties presently in control of our executive, therefore our country, don't know how to govern. They do not understand that mutual respect and equality was at the heart of the Belfast Agreement. And as we've heard today, they work together because they have to, not because they want to. And that lets down the Belfast Agreement, because you have to be in there and you have to want to govern. We want to be the largest unionist party. We want to work with the willing. No, I won't, sorry. We want to work with willing partners. We want to show respect to all who live in Northern Ireland, their identity, their culture, their traditions. Many people raise their eyes when I say, I'm Irish. And I am Irish. Now, if it's comfortable for you, prefix up with Northern if you want. But I'm also a proud Ulsterman. And I'm a fiercely proud Brit. But I am Irish. That term allows me, the Belfast Agreement allows me to say that. The Belfast Agreement allows the people to decide that Northern Ireland will remain part of the United Kingdom. The power is with the people, not with this room. So let's be clear. My identity is represented by the Union flag, by God Save the Queen, the 12th of July, Ulster Scots and the monarchy. But it's also represented by Shamrock, St Patrick's Day, the GAA, Irish dancing, the Irish language. They're all part of me. Madam Speaker, before I do run the length of myself, I have to say to everybody that it's all about the language we use that we have to be careful. People would be far more happy embracing or talking or having a conversation about the Irish language if we didn't have things or people throwing in our faces by saying every word of Irish spoken is like another bullet being fired in the struggle for Irish freedom. That does not help. It is a bad statement. I support the motion and I support dialogue, and we need dialogue. Thank you.
Éirim Sir John O'Dowd. I call John O'Dowd.
I also too wish you all the best for the future. I'm going to start my speech how I ended my last speech in the Assembly on the 19th of December, that infamous day, which in my opinion was a series of events which actually brought this Assembly to an end. And I said on that occasion that if the party opposite didn't realise or didn't work the office of the First Deputy First Minister as a joint office, then I doubt there would be an office. And the attitude displayed since has confirmed to me that the party opposite and others believe that they're almost returning to a unionist state, and a state where the Good Friday Agreement doesn't exist or matter, where power-sharing arrangements are an inconvenience rather than an actual legislative and political responsibility on all parties. And Mr Stalford said during his speech, and I'm not going to quote him because it's kind of exact terms, but he said, there is no going back. He's absolutely right. There is no going back. The only way government is going to operate in this state is under the terms of the Good Friday Agreement. And when there may or may not be talks in the future, because it's quite clear relationships have broken down, but talks are required at some stage in the future, the Good Friday Agreement will be the foundation upon which we build a society. Anyone who has it in their head that they're going to take apart the Good Friday Agreement is sorely mistaken. The only way any of us, if we're re-elected, will be standing in this chamber or a future executive will be on the principles of power sharing, respect and mutual understanding. That's the reality of the situation. I'll give way to Mr Stafford quickly.
I'd say that we wouldn't be going back to the dark days of the past, and I hope that is a conviction that's shared by everyone. I tell you something else we'll not be going back to. We'll not be going back to the days of you boys trotting in and out of Downing Street. For I know this is hard to believe. You're not the centre of the universe anymore.
First of all, the member will have an extra minute, but can I ask that members make comments through the chair?
Well, I've never believed myself to be the centre of the universe. But I am currently an elected representative, and my party has a significant mandate across the island of Ireland, which brings me to Mr. Logan's comment about some unionists, or maybe himself, I don't know if he said it exactly, have to hold their nose to share power with Sinn Féin. I don't care what part of your anatomy you have to hold on to make yourself feel comfortable. But I'll tell you what you'll not be doing. You'll not be looking down your nose at us. Are you not be looking down your nose at the people I represent or the people we represent? And that's part of the difficulty. If you look at another section of society, whether in this chamber or outside this chamber, and you believe they are your lesser, then what chance have we for our society? You refer to the fact that at the age of 9 you learnt about the Good Friday Agreement in school, or the Good Friday Agreement was signed. At the age of 9 I was burying two of my cousins and an uncle who was shot dead by state forces operating under the guise of the UDF. Now, you can tell me it was a few bad apples, and they were bad apples, but there was members of the RUC and the UDR in that gang. The Ganan gang, now infamous. You say you Googled names who were released from prison. I didn't Google the names of that gang. None of them, not a single one of them, went to prison for dozens of murders in the North Armagh area. So we've all hurt, we've all pained, we've all got all those sorts of things going on. But as a Republican 20 years ago, I and others had to make a decision. Did we believe that the Good Friday Agreement was an honourable way forward for Republicans? Was it a way forward which we could build peace? And yes, could we still move towards our ultimate objective of united Ireland? And in my head, after long deliberations, and people often reflect that unionists had to compromise to come into the power-sharing institutions. Republicans compromise. This is a huge compromise for Republicans. But was it the right thing to do? Of course it was the right thing to do. And I don't hold my nose to share power with anyone. I hold my head high. As a former minister and a power-sharing executive, I am proud to say I shared power with my Protestant and unionist neighbours. I'm proud of it. Proud of it. No one, and we get a lot of personal and at times physical abuse from so-called dissident Republicans. I have stood in front of many of them and I have told them I am proud to have shared power with my Protestant and Unionist neighbours. Despite our history, despite the conflict we've been through, despite the pain we've been through, despite all those things, proud to have done it. So perhaps when members on the other bench can stand up, even look at themselves in the mirror and ask themselves the question, are you proud to have tried to share power with your nationalist and Republican neighbours? Because if you can answer that question honestly in the positive, then I think there is hope for this society going into the future. But be under no illusions, it has to be on the basis of equality. It has to be on the basis of mutual respect. And it has to be on the basis that we are all equals with a very sad past behind of us, and none of us can look at each other and go, it was all your fault.
I call Richie McPhillips, and before I do that, can I just ask, remind members to speak through the chair. Richie McPhillips.
Thank you, Madam Deputy Principal Speaker. I welcome this opportunity to contribute to this evening's debate on the values and principles of the Good Friday Agreement, and I do so as a parent of now three adult children who were the young generation following the Troubles, and I, like many others, thought that the agreement meant a better future for them. The SDLP is a party that was born out of the civil rights movement, and it was instrumental in and totally committed to the core principles of the Good Friday Agreement and tied to the principles of social justice, reconciliation and prosperity. There have been many great people involved in the peace process who all played an instrumental role in changing the political and social dynamics of the north of this island. But it's important that we in this very chamber also remember people who don't always get the headlines. Women like Pat Hume and the late Gertrude Mallin, who have also played a pivotal role in this agreement. Madam Speaker, it's true that the North has come a long way since 1998, and despite recent events, people are no longer being murdered on our streets en masse, and it's fair to say that the agreement has undoubtedly saved thousands of lives that would otherwise have been taken by British state forces and various paramilitaries. But Madam Deputy Speaker, the Good Friday Agreement was about much more than peace and about much more than ending tribal warfare in our society. It presented a better, clearer vision for the future of settled relationships and prosperity, one which puts the needs of both sections of our community first. It was meant to bridge the gap that has only unfortunately widened since the devolution of powers to this institution. It was meant to provide political stability to the region that suppressed rights rather than enforced them. But here we are, almost 20 years later, and I have yet to see this Assembly gain its legislative spores. to start delivering for everyone in our society and to start making amends to the grievous injustice that has gone in the past. Rather than having mature politics, the political parties in this government have abused power to the benefit of their own. RHI, SIF, RSA, Charter NA, Red Sky, Community Hall funding, the decision to stop leaf abortion funding, have all recently laid bare the ineptitude of this institution and this government. Green and orange politics, Madam Deputy Speaker, that delivers for no one and does not conform to the principles that underpin this agreement. Later, the Assembly will debate the rights and victims of survivors who have campaigned for justice for the horrendous crimes that were committed against them by the state. Yet this institution has once again failed those individuals who have waited so long for justice. These institutions have also failed the victims of the Troubles, who have been unlawfully killed and maimed. There are still no answers for those families and individuals who have been wronged by the grievous crimes committed against them. And in the midst of current political uncertainty and the fall of these institutions, we have the growing shadow of Brexit hanging all over us that will disproportionately hit the north of Ireland. Wales has a plan, Scotland has a plan, but this executive has been found wanting once again. Borders of the past will be constructed and erected across border counties, and this will impact on travel, trade and investment. And it will be the people of the north who will suffer, and not the fat cats who advocated the Leave vote in the first place. That, Madam Deputy Speaker, is an indictment of this institution, and it's also an indictment on the Good Friday Agreement that calls for cross-border collaboration. Even if Article 50 is triggered next month, we have no seat at the table. We have no one advocating the best interests of the people of the North. It's clear that immature politics takes precedent over political and regional stability. Madam Deputy Speaker, this Assembly needs to be realistic about what is truly important. We can no longer go on carving up budgets, one piece orange and the next piece green. We need to start delivering for the best interests of the people of the North. We cannot continue with the scandal after scandal and suspension after suspension. We need mature politics, and we need it delivered here, and we need it delivered now. Madam Deputy Speaker, thank you very much, and may I wish you all the best for the future.
I call David Ford, but before I call David, just to let you know, you have 4 minutes, and there won't be, if you choose to take an intervention, you won't get an extra minute. My apologies for that.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. I'll still wish you well for the future. There's a certain irony that almost as we approach the end of this particular Assembly term, we're debating the issue of the fundamental principles of the Good Friday Agreement, the values and principles which are supposed to underpin everything we do, but which have been sadly lacking for some time. And yet in 1998, when some of us, and there's still, I think there are a dozen of us here, including three or four in the chamber at the moment, who were here in September 1998 when we first came into this place, who remember that as a time of hope, a time of optimism, a time of belief that things were really changing, a time when we were actually looking at three sets of relationships which defined the people of Northern Ireland and these islands and how we managed together. But there's absolutely no doubt that since that time, the eyes have been taken off the ball of some of the fundamental issues. And we are going to need some significant reforms if we're to restore public trust in the ability of the Assembly and the Executive to deliver for the people of Northern Ireland. And part of that problem is because of the watering down of the fundamental principles of the Good Friday Agreement, which we've seen on a number of occasions over the last 17 years. For example, the St Andrews Agreement, which removed the issue of First Minister and Deputy First Minister being elected jointly. It may only have been optics, but it was significant optics that they would seem to have the confidence of the House. The fact that in those early days, David Trimble and Seamus Mallon sat beside each other at question time on alternate sides of the chamber was optics, but it was significant optics. And the watering down at St Andrews by the DUP and Sinn Féin and the two governments took away a lot of that positive engagement and left us in difficulties there. And of course, 14 months ago, we had the so-called Fresh Start, which Stevie Agnew credited to me as the false dawn document. In fairness, I only said it was a false dawn for victims on the day, but a year on, it's pretty clear it's a false dawn for absolutely everybody. And again, that was a stitch up between two governments and the two largest parties, rather than what is referenced here in the motion, an inclusive process which would engage all of us, because it was when all of us had the opportunity to be engaged in the run-up to Good Friday that we made some difference. But I do have to say to my friend Colin McGrath, who wasn't here in the early days, it wasn't actually perfection in the days when the Ulster Unionists and the SDLP were the two largest parties either. We've only got to take Seamus Mallon's recent article as an example of what wasn't even covered by the Ulster Unionist Party in those days and the way he felt treated. And I can personally remember saying on one occasion we would give a programme for government 7 out of 10 if we were Scotland or Wales, but the Alliance group voted against it because it didn't address the fundamental issues of overcoming divisions and building a united community in this society, which has been left out completely. And of course we've also had things like the watering down of the engagement of committees in the budgetary process since last May, another fundamental issue that when we talk about committees being there to advise and assist ministers, well, if ministers don't allow that to happen, ministers in the current executive have lost us that as well. Steve Agnew highlighted a number of the issues which we do need to address. We need to address the issues of openness around party funding. We need to address some way of moving towards a more normal kind of voluntary coalition with a suitable weighted majority. We need to do something to ensure the petition of concern is only triggered on fundamental issues and not on every social reform that the largest party doesn't like. And we need to do something to get away from the designations which divide us rather than uniting us. There's a lot that needs to be done if we're to make a real difference, and if we don't find some way of getting into serious talks when we come back here, then we will not be delivering for the people of Northern Ireland. Like John O'Dowd, I'm proud of what I did as a minister, but I'm certainly not proud of the way this Assembly has been treated by the Executive over the last 8 months.
Thank you, Principal Deputy Speaker. In his contribution, Mike Nesbitt made the point that he didn't want to see a constitutional convention and us going back to the people after the election. The 90 MLA should come back and get on with the job. And I suppose it's a fundamental difference between representative democracy, where we go by the electorate and say, elect us and we will reflect your views, and a participative democracy that I think which is a continual engagement and we continually seek the views of the electorate. Because I don't think it's enough to go once every 5 years for a mandate. I think it has to be a continuing dialogue. And I would use the recent referendum in Europe as an example. And Gerry Kelly made the point, people have spoken 20 years ago. And I do think, again, people deserve more of an engagement than that, and I think it's what went wrong with the UK within reference to the European Union, whereas the Republic of Ireland, where there were changes to what they signed up to, they go back to referendum, whether it be Lisbon, Maastricht or whatever it might be. In the UK we were told... I'll take a point.
He cites the Republic of Ireland in terms of its relationship with the European Union and referenda. Of course, we know what happened there is when the political elite got the wrong answer, they simply had another referendum until they got the answer that they wanted.
And the member has an extra minute.
I thank the member. And they went back to the people and the people gave a different answer. And I think that the people are entitled to change their mind and have done so. But the point is, Ireland is seen as a country and through various referenda have shown itself to be a country that supports its position in Europe. In the UK, where people were told, well, we sorted that issue in 1975, I don't care if you've been born since, you don't get another say, we've changed it, just the EU's good, like it. I support the EU, but I don't support that disengagement, and it's no wonder that we talk about Europe as if it's something separate from us rather than something we're part of, that it's something that happens to us rather than actually something we're part of, and indeed our MEPs and ministers help shape. So I think we do need something that is more participative in our democracy. And again, I see it as a preventative measure, because we have had continual crisis, you know, and every time you list it, whether it be the Hart talks or the Haas talks or Stormont House or Hillsborough, St Andrews. You can go through the list and think if I left one out, because there's been so many. And even when it came to this current crisis, I was kind of, I've only been in full-time politics since 2007. I think this was my fourth crisis, and I kind of rolled my eyes and went to another one. We need something to change. We need something to change. We can't go on like this, and it's not for me. It's not direct rule at the other side of the elections or some form of joint government. It is negotiations, as a number of people have said, are likely. But it should be negotiations that are open and transparent and engage our citizens, rather than that are kept from them until we come out with some form of agreement that's presented. And they have no say as to whether or not it's the agreement they wanted. They will elect their political parties and told, well, we represented you in those negotiations. We can't see that. There's no transparency. And I don't think it's enough. There are a number of issues, and both Stephen Farry and David Ford highlighted some of those that I highlighted around community designation, around petition of concern. And I think even some of the language that's used has showed us that we're 20 years on, and at times it can feel like we're no further on. And I don't believe that we are. I believe in a better place. But at times when I still hear language of two communities, we live in a very diverse Northern Ireland. That is not the language of today. That is the language of 20 years ago. And I think whilst we still have parties that say we represent the whole of Northern Ireland, but yet seek their vote from one section of Northern Ireland, I think we'll continue to have problems.
Does the member not put his finger on part of the malfunction and something that will never function properly within the Belfast Agreement, namely that in fact, by virtue of the system it has created, it entrenches sectarianism. It entrenches one bloc to play off against the other, which defeats what's supposed to be its purpose.
I agree with the member. I think it does enshrine sectarianism, and I think we need to move on from it. I suspect we would disagree on how we do that, but I would like to disagree in a constitutional convention along with our citizens and to come to a conclusion that gets the endorsement of the people of Northern Ireland, as the Good Friday Agreement did. To finish, Principal Deputy Speaker, and I, too, like everyone else, once again wish you well. People are looking at Stormont at the minute.
Can the member
thinking,
bring his remarks to a close?
I will do. People are looking at Stormont thinking, I could do better. We could do better. I agree with them. Let's give them the chance.
Iremsa Er Clare Hanna. I call on Clare Hanna to wind
thank
on
you,
the motion.
Thank you, Madam Speaker. And like others, I wish you well in life after this Assembly. And I hope that we're not all joining you in life after this Assembly in the next couple of months. And I want to thank all of those who've participated in the debate, which has been an important review of the principles. And as members have said, it is a bit sad, perhaps, that we're only restating and discussing those principles now. I actually feel old because Philip Logan was only 9 back then and I was just coming 18, but I do remember that sense of possibility and optimism that I think is fair to say is not present in this building in recent months and is absent from our politics, but we don't believe it has to be, and of course nobody is going to lose sight of how far we've come. Nobody said that, Mr. Ford, that it was perfect, and I think that is very clear. I'm not quite old enough to be able to dig out sort of memoirs of Oliver Napier and Brian Faulkner, who I suspect had their relationship difficulties as well in making things up and running. But I don't think we can ignore the external context in those early days of devolution, which was the overplaying of the decommissioning hand and the DUP screaming in the windows of this Assembly. And I think Malin and Trimble did an incredible job with the progress they did make at that time. Colin McGrath moving the motion referred to the appalling shooting last night of a public servant, a member of the PSNI, as an illustration of what we failed to eliminate and what we're definitely not returning to. But as we said, that opportunity has been squandered, and that's a lot of the story of the last probably 60 years of politics here, and certainly the last 20 years. And we think that's not the fundamental design, but the failure to live up to the spirit and the substance of the agreement in a lot of the everyday decisions, but over the years on the big picture stuff around weapons, policing, respect, parity, failure to make any meaningful progress on North-South, and with the North-South Ministerial Committee watered down and sidelined.
I appreciate the member give way. Would she agree that there's actually an issue between the values of the Good Friday Agreement, the architecture of the agreement, and the way in which it was implemented, and there were failings in both the second and the third?
I would, and I was going to come to that, and Stephen Farry raised a number of points about the ugly scaffolding, and we have said that there can and there should be evolution in that. I think John McAllister did us all a service when he put some of those mechanisms on the table, and I think we all engaged with that in good faith, and that is something that can be revisited. But I have to agree with Alec Maskey, I don't feel that we can eliminate some of those mechanisms, and I believe the proof of the pudding has been in the eating, and how government has been done, and how minorities have been treated. So we're up for that discussion, but I haven't seen a perfect alternative proposal yet. Just regarding the Green Party amendment, and I definitely appreciate we appreciate the intention of it, but and we are for maximum civic participation, including re-establishment of the civic forum, and for engaging people in the ways that we can. But we do feel this period after the election is do or die. We don't have a very long time. We need to get governance back up and running to deal with a lot of the issues we've been discussing, not least Brexit and delivering for survivors of abuse and for victims. And with the best will in the world, we don't see how a constitutional convention, even though the model in the South has been very constructive, we don't see how that can be enacted and delivered within the very narrow window that we have. Yes.
Take her point, but no point if I said she'd be in that 3-week window. I think regardless of whether or not we get through the 3 weeks and these institutions are up and running, we still need to have this, because you pointed out the issues, for example, of victims. They haven't been solved since 1998, so if it takes a year's very little time in comparison.
Just in the context of the motion being about the talks that follow this election to prevent there being a second election, simply because even if this one won't solve anything, another one certainly won't. But we don't feel that the window of opportunity, but very happy to come back to it, hopefully in these refresh institutions. And just to pick up on another few points, Chris, in quite constructive mode, really, I thought, but I still think probably failed to grasp the fundamentals of the equality envisaged in the Good Friday Agreement in your rejection of 50-50, and as Mike Nesbitt said, that it resulted in a police service that the whole community has been able to buy into, and again, that's something that I think we couldn't do without. Mike Nesbitt and Stephen Farry were among a number of members to raise the key issue of Brexit and its potential to damage very fundamentally, not obviously just our economy, but our politics. And I think tomorrow morning at about 9:30, we'll probably be a lot clearer of some of the political and constitutional issues, and we hope obviously that the Supreme Court do reinforce the authority of the devolved institutions here and elsewhere. And if they do, and I hope they do, it would be an appalling dereliction of duty if we are not here to take up that responsibility and to give that voice. So I think any talks that follow, yes, I'd be happy to.
Lady, to be fair to her, has been consistently pro-European. Her and I clashed repeatedly in the referendum, but I think always in a generous way. She agreed with me that it is absolute rank hypocrisy for a party that's collapsing these institutions to continue to refuse to go to Westminster, where they will have a vote, I suspect, on the issue of leaving the European Union.
Well, I speak for the SDLP only. I agree. I don't feel that anybody elected here in any of the 18 Westminster seats is a better Irishman than Parnell or Davitt or many other Irishmen who went to Westminster and represented. Anywhere we are, our future is being discussed. The SDLP will be there to deliver on our pledges there. As I said, you did raise Stephen Farry, the ugly scaffolding, and we are up for that as well. Gerry Kelly gave a very spirited defence of the Good Friday Agreement and all that hasn't been realised that would have rung a little bit truer from a party that hasn't been driving the government for the last decade. And I think, Colin McGrath made the point that despite disappointment in the stop and start of progress, if we found ourselves 20 years back, we would still push and try and deliver for the Good Friday Agreement, because we think the fact is that the core analysis of John Hume's three stands still stands. The implementation of how it's been delivered in relationships within Northern Ireland on an east-west and a north-south basis have been not fully implemented, but we think if we had returned to those, and we could return to those principles, we would be in much better shape. And we think those principles haven't been in evidence in government because effectively the government has been driven by people who never really bought into them, and the DUP have, and at least you've been open about it, have been attempting to rewrite and remake for your own purposes those structures, and we just don't feel that they've been adequately defended by your enablers in Sinn Féin. So while all structures can evolve, we think the various degradations in Stormont House and St Andrews and so on weren't agreed by all parties and certainly were not endorsed by the people north and south of these islands, like the Good Friday Agreement. And we think that those parties who thought they knew better and decided to go it alone, we saw the outworkings of that in the programme for government negotiations in May, and we are now seeing the very grim final outworkings of that, when all of the criticisms we made of governance and how it was and wasn't being done here are now being restated by those people who dismissed our criticism. Looking ahead, it is difficult to see exactly where we go from here, but we believe that the foundation stones are still there in the three strands of the Good Friday Agreement and in the sort of unwritten fourth strand in my head that I think of around the European dimension. The alternatives just don't bear thinking about. We're not going back to what we had last night, and we certainly do not want to go back to direct rule by certainly this government. And just briefly, I will reference the SDLP's joint authority proposals, which were joint authority and not joint sovereignty, because we firmly respect the principle of consent. But I will be very clear that our first, second, third, fourth, fifth preference before that is to re-establish power sharing and local administration here. I think the agreement and its outworkings driven by those people who want to work them could deliver a very different future. And I must say I did take some hope from Mr O'Dowd's comments that he has been proud to share power, and I think that has been lacking. Parties wanting to share power and who see power sharing as a virtue and not just something they do because, as Mr Beattie Douglas tells us, that the law told them they had to do it. But to make it work, we have to restore that mutual trust. That's what the Good Friday Agreement was about, the belief that getting around the table and working together in all our common interests would build up the trust. We haven't seen that trust build up over the last 20 years, but we believe it still can, and the electorate have the opportunity to make that choice. Thank you.
The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. And the call to evolver, all those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Well, clear the lobbies. I'm hearing voices from both sides of the House and both sides of the argument. Clear the lobbies. It will be put in 3 minutes. Order. Order, members. Can members please take their seats? Order. Order, members. Can members please take their seats?
The question is that the amendment standing on the Marshall list be made. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, if any, no.
No.
I think the noes have it. The noes have it. The question is that the motion as amended. Sorry, Gomleshgill. The question is that the motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, no.
No.
Clear the lobbies. The question will be put in 3 minutes. The motion standing on the order paper be agreed. All those in favour say aye.
Aye.
Contrary, if any, no.
No.
Do we have tellers? Order. Order. I'm going to have to shout louder. Can we have some order, please? Tellers have been appointed as follows. Tellers for the ayes are Colin McGrath and Justin McNulty. Tellers for the noes are Christopher Stalford and George Robinson. Clear the lobbies. The Assembly will divide. Ayes to my right, noes to my left. Can I ask members to resume their seats? Can I ask members to resume their seats? Clerk, can you please read the results?
85 members voted, 54 members voted aye, 31 members voted no. The motion is carried.
The motion is carried. Unfasten the doors.